And today we'll discuss about the molecular basis of cancer. And this cancer, as an overview of cancer, is given by MCI as 10.1 and 10.2 of the competencies list. And we'll discuss it in three parts, where we'll have a induction of cancer and the cell characters in the first part. And secondly, we'll discuss about the oncogenes, and finally tumor markers. In the middle of it, we'll have carcinogenesis, how it is happening actually. So we'll go start the session, and this session we'll discuss mostly about the cancer definition, characteristics of the cancer cell, and we'll define what is a carcinogen, and we'll classify carcinogens and describe various mechanisms by which carcinogens cause cancer. I want to make a point here. We will discuss the things which are important for the undergraduate medical students only, and not deeper than that. And finally, a small test. There are some assays which will help you to identify the carcinogenic potential of any chemical. Those will be discussed in this session. So, starting with what is cancer? Basically, the important aspect of cancer is the most important cause of cancer and the reference for cancer is we should know about it, because it is the second important cause of death in the world. And a neoplasm is referring to an abnormal new growth. Neo refers to new, and it is a growth of tissue. And believe me, if you want to find a real growth of a tissue, it will take at least 10 years after the basic molecular change have been initiated in any of the cell. That is why knowing the molecular basis will help you to prevent cancer than to treat it. If you know how is it happening and where is it happening beforehand, before the tumor is, before any visible tumor or palpable tumor is there, if you know it basically before it is happening, you can stop it. Okay, because stage is important, when you treat is very important. And now, it can be a benign or malignant in nature. You call it a cancer only when it is malignant. A benign tissue cannot be called as a cancer unless it is turning into malignant or it is having some malignant characteristics. And the important characteristic features of a cancer cell. Cancer, the word, it refers to crab, which can walk in any direction. Okay, it's an abnormal growth. It can spread in any direction. It's an abnormal shape. It's not. It doesn't follow in any of the rules of normal human cells, and it is a different shape. And loss of contact inhibition and reduced requirement of nutrients and growth factors. This cancer cell will not require the nutrients and growth factors as a normal cell. It is stimulated with a different process of stimulus, and it is not under the normal regulations. These are the different characteristics of a cancer cell, and this can be summarized in a small diagram from Harper. It is self-sustaining. It doesn't depend on a growth signal to start its growth. Okay. And next, evasion of growth suppressors. The growth suppressors, which are the normal borders or the normal borderline proteins, which will help you to stop the growth, are not influencing a cancer cell. And activation of invasion and metastasis. These cancer cells, they creep from the tissue of their origin into the circulation, and from there they spread into a different tissue, and they have a limitless replicative growth potential. And they are resistant to apoptosis, which is a programmed cell death. Any old cell in the body is subjected to a phenomena called apoptosis, which is not a controller of cancer cell. Apoptosis is beaten up by the cancer cell. And finally, any blood cell in the body or any tissue which is wanting to survive, it needs a blood supply, and that is called angiogenesis. This tumor cells have a potential to build up their own vascular supply. That's called angiogenesis. These are the different characteristic features of a cancer cell. Okay, and coming to the metabolic changes. The metabolic changes what we observe in cancer cells can be just classified into these things. They can be listed out like this. And the most important first metabolic feature is increased and rapid DNA replication and transcription. Because every cell needs its DNA, and the DNA must be synthesized rapidly for this level of growth. and cell surface molecule expression abnormalities, what we talked about, contact inhibition. The contact inhibition is lost because of the abnormalities in the expression of cell surface molecules. And Warburg effect, a frequently asked MCQ from your NEET examinations. What is Warburg effect? The Warburg effect means increased anaerobic glycolysis. Because the cell is rapidly dividing and it goes into a hypoxic state because of the rapid division, and this increases the anaerobic glycolysis. This also explains the lactic acidosis in cancer patients. And fetal enzyme and protein expression, like what we heard, what we hear most often, alpha fetoprotein. And mitochondrial alterations. This is what I called, I talked about apoptosis. The mitochondria is the key organelle which is deciding a cell to be living or dying, because it is energy powerhouse. And also this mitochondria will decide by apoptosis whether the cell is going to live or not. And this, there are abnormalities in mitochondria also in a cancer cell. And altered antigenic expression. A cancer cell does not give out normal antigens. It gives different antigens. Okay. Next. Now, coming to carcinogen. As the word goes, carcinogen. Anything that generates cancer, anything that can induce a cancer, anything that can cause a proliferative change in any cell is called a carcinogen. It is a mutagenic change. Remember, any cancer starts with a small change in a DNA of any one single cell. Okay, so these carcinogens are classified as physical agents, chemical agents, and biological agents. In physical agents, they include radiation like UV light, X-rays, and gamma radiation. Chemicals, I gave the cigarette smoke example because it is the most commonly known. And there are also some many other chemicals which are a part of effluents of many industries. And biologicals like viruses, there are different carcinogens which are classified. And coming to the how it causes cancer radiation, the ionizing radiation, X-rays, and anti-tumor drugs, they are causing DNA lesions like this. They can cause a double stranded break, single stranded break. They can cause a cross-linking between the strands, okay, which is not normal, and that is, that can generate a mutation in the DNA and which can be further proceeding into a carcinogenic state. And UV light, they form bulky adducts and pyrimidine dimers. I won't list out those things. These are the different things what is happening to the DNA because of radiation. Okay, formation of pyrimidine dimers, formation of apurinic or pyrimidine sites by elimination of it can remove a base from them, and formation of single or double stranded breaks or cross-linking of DNA strands. These are the basic changes which are caused by radiation. Please remember, it is the amount of radiation is also very important. Before any radiation can, it should, the exposure is also very important. UV rays, X-rays, and gamma rays are mutagenic and carcinogenic. If the mutation is not corrected, then it is called a carcinogenic mutation and it can go into the next stage of cancer. X-rays and gamma rays can induce other formation of reactive oxygen species. These reactive oxygen species are potentially dangerous and they cause lipid peroxidation of membranes and damage to the cells. And these reactive oxygen species can also damage DNA, thereby producing mutations. And it is also important that the amount and intensity of exposure to the radiation is also significantly contributing for the carcinogenic effect of any radiation you are exposed. Because if you go back to the history, the continuous exposure, more amount of exposure is known to cause more amount of cancers than less amount of exposure. Okay, so, and decreases with increasing melanin. For example, if you say some cancers, some melanomas are very rare in Indian population. Why? Because we have an increased amount of melanin, more amount of melanin than Western population, where they have very less melanin in the skin and they are more prone to melanomas than Indian scenario. So the amount of melanin is also very protective against the skin cancers. Coming to the chemical carcinogens, this is a tabular form from Harper. Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons like benzopyrene, dimethylbenzanthracene, and aromatic amines like acetyl aminofluorine, N-methyl aminoazobenzene. And remember, anything running around benzene, a benzene ring, aromatic hydrocarbons are actually dangerous, and you cannot have them in and around in your places. And nitrosamines, dimethyl nitrosamine, diethyl nitrosamine, alkylating agent, cyclophosphamide. This cyclophosphamide is actually in some cases used as an anti-cancer agent, but it can be a potential carcinogenic also. And naturally occurring compounds, aflatoxin B1. I think you know all these. Well, if you know aflatoxin, what is aflatoxin? A black dotted groundnut, peanut, is an aflatoxin containing groundnut. Please do not have it. You just spit it out. Okay, any abnormal tasting groundnut is potentially having an aflatoxin. And coming to the how they are the chemical carcinogens, how they are actually causing the cancer. Most chemical carcinogens are binding covalently with the DNA and thereby forming a wide range of nucleotide adducts, what we discussed, like pyrimidine dimers. The pyrimidine dimers and adduct molecules which are being formed in the DNA of each cell, they can be carcinogenic. And some chemicals interact directly with the DNA, like meclothamine and beta propionolactone. But others, some procarcinogens, they require activation into carcinogens, and this activation happens by different enzymes. Okay, finally, the chemical carcinogen, whatever carcinogen it is there, it is electrophilic molecule. It's electron loving molecule which is deficient in electrons, and it attacks the DNA where there are excess of electrons, like the CG area and AT areas where there are double bonds, triple bonds. It can attack the nucleophilic groups in the DNA and thereby take the electrons and thereby cause a point mutation or a different multiple mutations. And apart from this, whatever chemicals we are consuming, these carcinogenic chemicals, they are converted or activated into carcinogens by a cytochrome P450 systems in our endoplasmic reticulum. That's a part of detoxification, which the compound may be converted into more toxic substances in some cases. In very few cases, these chemicals which we consume directly or indirectly, or we are exposed to, they are taken up by the body, and the P450 system located in the endoplasmic reticulum will try to modify it or to detoxify it. In this process, the P450 system may make it more carcinogenic. So that's a potential disaster caused by the body itself. And coming to the Emmy's test, this Emmy's test is an assay where if you have a doubt, like a chemical is it carcinogenic or not, we do this Emmy's test. Okay, this Emmy's test is like putting that particular chemical in a agar plate where there is a salmonella type medium growing, and you see for the colonies after a period of incubation. Okay, and in this test we can actually modify this test to identify the mammalian endoplasmic reticulum to the assay to make it identify the procarcinogens. And this is the process of, and add the bacteria that requires, that is actually Salmonella typhimurium, and add a suspected mutagen, and the chemical is diffused, incubate it for a three or four days as per the protocol. And if the chemical is a mutagen, what happens is this, there are multiple colonies getting formed, and if it is not a mutagen, it is far fewer colonies. Okay, this diagram is taken from actually again Harper. And please remember, Emmy's test is most of the carcinogenic chemicals, they pass the Emmy's test. Very few chemicals which doesn't pass Emmy's test are carcinogenic. This have been proven research. And remember, compounds that alter epigenetic factors, these can without MEIS test positive, they are not tested MEIS test positive, they can predispose to cancer because they are not mutagenic. They don't cause mutation, but they cause methylation and they cause histone post-translational modifications of histones. Okay, these may not be testing positive for MEIS test. This is a significant exception here because this can be a potential MCQ for you in an exam where they are mostly asking about exceptions. Okay, and coming to the next agent, we have discussed the radiation which is causing cancer. Where secondly, we discussed about the chemicals which are carcinogenic, and finally, we are coming to the carcinogenic viruses. Coming to the carcinogenic viruses, sorry, difference. These carcinogenic viruses are Epstein-Barr virus, which is associated, which is a DNA virus associated with Burkitt's lymphoma, nasopharyngeal cancer, and B-cell lymphoma, hepatitis B and C viruses, which are differing in the genetic makeup. Hepatitis C is RNA virus and hepatitis B is a DNA virus. And hepatitis C virus is most dangerous to cause hepatocellular carcinoma. Hepatitis B is a, it can also cause, but a chronic exposure. And herpes virus 8 will cause Kaposi sarcoma. And HPV, the dreaded cervical cancer, is because of HPV. And human T-cell lymphoma virus, leukemia virus type 1 is also causing red T-cell leukemia. So these are the different aspects of carcinogens and cancer cells. It's an abnormal growth. Cancer is an abnormal growth caused by various factors, both genetic and environmental. And cancer cells divide, proliferate and spread at an at a greater potential than a normal cell. And radiation, chemicals and viruses can cause cancer. MEIS test is an assay to detect carcinogens.